Hello everyone. I hope you are all well and safe. Today I present to you my lecture recital titled John Kander and Fred Ebb, The World Itself as a Stage. One of the questions that I asked myself before starting the process of creating this recital was what in fact did I want to discover? As an undergraduate, I encountered a great many types of repertoire, genres, ranging from English Baroque arias to Latin American folk song to contemporary Broadway staples. And from these diverse song encounters, I found myself drawn to the genre of musical theater. It was even more clear where my interests were drawn as looking through my repertoire binder, the musical theater genre was predominant. A highlight was my go-to audition ballad, Sometimes a Day Goes By, by John Kander and Fred Ebb. A simple yet very emotional ballad. Lyrically, the song offers an actor the tools of a variety of scenery within its many short sentences. Every time I'd perform it, I knew I needn't have to worry about acting, because this song would take me on a ride to another land of remembering pain and loneliness. The words would always strike with such impact that it did not take much to have my eyes gather the weight of tears. I had to find out how material like this piece was created. Who, how, where, and what came into the minds of Kander and Ebb to create such a piece. Because of this song, I decided to dive into the life of this iconic duo. Musical theater is a form of theatrical performance that combines songs, spoken dialogue, acting, and dance. I haven't always been a fan of the genre. In fact, I was partially dragged into it by my incredible undergraduate music teacher from Miami-Dade College, Amy Davis. She pushed me into the realms of the Golden Age classics such as Carousel by Rodgers and Hammerstein, as well as into the contemporary musical comedy of the modern I Love You, You're Perfect Now Change by Joe DiPietro and Jimmy Roberts. While these were a great introduction to musical theater, it wasn't until I discovered Kander and Ebb's material that I was personally impacted by the genre. Many of their lyrics offered an honest interpretation of true life in a musical world. Many of their lyrics offered an honest interpretation of true life in a musical world that began to draw me in. The act of celebrating was no longer just about community and romance as seen in Rodgers and Hammerstein's Oklahoma, but about celebrating self-love in a modern world. This concept of self-love was needed for me as an aspiring artist, especially during a time of tremendous challenge and growth, both academically and musically. I had never really understood what the concept of self-love meant until the discovery of Kander and Ebb's music. One can say it was the meteor that came into my life and helped awaken my urge to enjoy the fullness of embracing one's true, authentic self.
Sitting alone in your room, come hear the music play. Life is a cabaret, oh charm, come to the cabaret. Put down the knitting, the book and the broom, it isn't that long a stay. Life is a cabaret, oh charm, come to the cabaret. Come taste the wine, come hear the band, come blow your horn, start celebrating. Right this way, your table's waiting. Put down the knitting, the book and the broom, it isn't that long a stay. Life is a cabaret, oh charm, come to the cabaret. I used to have this girlfriend known as Elsie, with whom I shared four sorted rooms in Chelsea. She wasn't what you'd call a blushing flower. As a matter of fact, she rented by the hour. The day she died, the neighbors came to snicker.
Well, that's what comes with too much pills and liquor.
But when I saw her laid out like a queen, she was the happiest corpse I'd ever seen. I think of Elsie to this very day. I remember how she turned to me and said,
what good is sitting alone in your room? Come hear the music playing. Life is a cabaret, old chum, come to the cabaret. Ah! Down the knitting, the book and the broom, it isn't that long a stay. Life is a cabaret, old chum, come to the cabaret. And as for me, I made my mind up back in Chelsea. When I go, I'm going like Elsie. Stop by admitting from cradle to, it isn't that long a stay. Life is a cabaret, oh charm, only a cabaret, oh charm, and I love a cabaret.
The title song, Cabaret, was chosen to catapult this lecture into the avant-garde using a song from a time where Kander and Ebb had found their voice. The song, famously sung by the great Liza Minnelli, features lyrics that comically takes advice from someone who lived life to the fullest and died a happy corpse. How does a duo walking out of the golden age era reach an aesthetic so surreal? What were they trying to achieve? I was compelled to learn more about the creative genius that would explore the dark depths of wartime Berlin cabaret. We start with, who was John Kander? John Kander was born into a musical middle-class Jewish family on March 18, 1927. His father, Harold, insisted on a home environment full of love and healthy interest in the arts for John and his brother, Edward. Kander gives an example of his aunt, Rita, who introduced him to the piano, more specifically, how her fingers created harmony on the keys. A mesmerizing experience. His parents regularly brought him and his brother to local theater and orchestra concerts, and even took them on a special yearly trip to New York City. Kander attended his first opera performance at the age of 9, when the San Carlo Opera came to Kansas City with their productions of Aida and Madame Butterfly. According to Kander,
I don't remember the first piece because I sort of grew up with it all the time, and I was listening from the time I was very young. I do remember seeing the first opera I ever saw in Kansas City when I was 10. A little company came through and they did Aida. I was in the first row with my feet dangling in the celli, looking up at these enormous people. And I was really overwhelmed by it.
Kander's musical juggle with the U.S. Army. During the early 1940s, a young Kander joined the United States Merchant Marine Cadet Corps. These Merchant Marines primarily transported cargo and passengers during peacetime, and at times of war were called upon to deliver military personnel and material for the military. After completing some basic training and traveling around the world, Kander leaves the Merchant Marine Corps in 1946. Kander was accepted into the Oberlin Conservatory of Music. But right after completing his first semester there, rule changes within the governing national services forced him to enlist in the Army Reserves that same year. He served a year at Fort Bragg in North Carolina. And this time, he organized a 7-piece dance band, which allowed Kander to stay musically active and remain in good standings with his superiors at the Army Reserves. Even during his time serving, he found a way to remain actively engaged with his music. I admire how John Kander was consistent despite setbacks and challenges. John Kander took advantage of the GI Bill, which helped develop war veterans and got them back to college. Kander earned his composition degree in 1951 at Oberlin and then proceeded to enter the master's program at Columbia University. Kander earned his composition master's degree from there. Things weren't all fine and dandy after this, though. The military struggle continued as Kander was forced to sell his apartment in New York City because he was ordered back into active duty. However, there was an unexpected revelation when a physician discovered scars on his lungs. He was forced to remain in New York for medical examination for a half year, and finally he was discharged in 1957. Army struggles ended, and Kander was able to focus on music. Unlike many other composers of their time who were running away from traditional music tonality, like Stephen Sondheim, Kander was not inclined to compose in that style. Kander mentioned that his music composer inspirations range from the Baroque era's Bach, to the classical era's Mozart, to late Romantic era's Wagner. Kander participated in the Columbia Opera Workshop, a highly regarded program at the time, which included participants such as the founding directors of the Santa Fe Opera, John Crosby. Kander acted as the musical assistant or musical conductor for operatic works, which included The Beggar's Opera. Participation in Columbia University's workshop was key in Kander's development as a composer. The head of the music department at the time, Douglas Moore, composer of the ballad of Baby Doe, said to Kander that if he could start over, he would instead write musicals. This as Kander expressed an equal interest in opera and musicals. This was a key influence to Kander's choice to focus on musical theater composition. Kander earned a living coaching singers, playing auditions, and conducting summer stock productions. One fateful day at the Variety Club in Philadelphia, while waiting in line to order a drink, Kander met a man by the name of Joe Lewis, who was a pianist for Sondheim's West Side Story. Kander, being his unaggressive self in a line of super aggressive people craving an alcoholic beverage, was asked by the gentleman what drink he wanted and what he would get Kander for his drink. That led to conversation, where they exchanged information. Their meeting led to an opportunity for Kander to sub for Lewis when he went on vacation. That was the first time Kander got to directly work with Sondheim material professionally. While subbing, he met choreographer and producer Jerome Robbins, who engaged Kander to accompany his show Gypsy and later write the dance music for the show. Kander's success grew, and by 1962, music publisher Tommy Valando took notice and thought, why not arrange a meeting for Kander with another client of his by the name of Fred Ebb? Now, who was Fred Ebb? Fred Ebb grew up in New York City as the only male sibling in a dysfunctional family. Unlike Kander, Ebb's parents never really took him to theater. In fact, they showed a lack of interest and did not support his enthusiasm for the arts. His first exposure to the world of musical theater came in the form of cast recordings. As he matured, Ebb turned to his friends and theater to escape from the realities of his home. Ebb was known for his incredible scholarly demeanor, as he was the valedictorian of his graduating class at DeWitt Clinton High School. Ebb's interest in writing began when he took a seminar on short stories at New York University. This led to a decision to pursue writing in college. He earned a bachelor's degree in English literature at NYU and earned his master's in English literature from Columbia University in 1957. While working a series of jobs unrelated to his profession, such as a bronze shoe salesman, Ebb played with light verse limericks, which impressed his friends who encouraged him to write lighter material professionally. This led to Ebb sending lyrics to record companies, where he successfully was signed to staff composers who had little to no actual contact with Ebb. However, he did work directly with songwriter Phil Springer, best known for writing the classic Christmas song Santa Baby. Springer enhanced Ebb's abilities as a writer turned songwriter by tutoring Ebb on structure and rhyme scheme. Their collaboration was short, and afterwards, Ebb met a composer named Paul Klein. Klein was a precursor to what was to come for Ebb. It was with Klein that Ebb wrote some of his breakthrough musical theater. The duo garnered success as they contributed songs and sketches for the 1960 musical review From A to Z, a show that marked the debut of great American film director Woody Allen and American composer and lyricist Jerry Herman. But alas, just like with Springer, the collaboration between Klein and Ebb was cut short as Klein quit the business to pursue a more secure livelihood. Re-enters musical publisher Tommy Volando, back from that Kander story, right? In 1962, who sees and takes notice of Ebb's success and sets up a meeting for Ebb with another client of his. In comes the meet and greet. The meeting was at Ebb's apartment, where discussion of songwriting and musical theater took place. It was a case of instant communication and instant song, Ebb recalled, because we worked in the same room at the same time. I didn't have to finish the lyric, then had it over to Kander to compose it. When we first began to work together, we fell into a way of working that allowed us to enjoy what we were doing. We just fell into a way of writing that was pleasurable. Kander and Ebb developed an instant rapport with one another. They even called each other Freddie and Johnny. They wrote novelty numbers for club acts, anything that would keep them working and earning enough to pay rent. Kander suggested, hey, why not try writing a ballad sometime? This first ballad was known as My Coloring Book. The song earned Grammy and Emmy nominations. This brought tremendous attention to Kander and Ebb. American actress, comedian, and singer Kate Ballard was given the opportunity to sing the song after her successful performance of another more comedic Kander and Ebb song called Sara Lee. On the once popular Perry Como's Craft Music Hall, with a comedic lyric content and a talk-on-pitch character song approach, Sara Lee, written by the iconic duo of John Kander and Fred Ebb, offers an early look at the duo's style of writing. Emphasizing character songs, a very simplistic accompaniment aligned with the melodic line, which simply complements the hysterical lyrics about an obsession with a cheesecake known as Sara Lee. There's a lady living somewhere. Where it is, I do not know. But I long to write and tell her that I love her so. I believe I might do mayhem. Yes, I might destroy myself. If I ever found her missing from my grocer shelf. Sara Lee, Sara Lee, your brioche just fractures me. Give me a taste of that cherry Danish. My mother bakes well, but you can't compare, not with Sara Lee. Sara Lee. Drop that H, say Sara Lee, and that's okay by me. Cause I'm living in paradise when I'm nibbling an apple spice from the kitchens of the one I love. Wonderful Sara Lee, Sara Lee. Drop that H, say Sara Lee. Cousin Milton works at the Hilton. He caters banquets, and at each affair he'll swear by Sara Lee. Oh baby, Sara Lee. Drop that H, say Sara Lee, and that's okay by me. I love a cheesecake white as pearl. And did I mention that juggly swirl from the kitchens of the one I love? Wonderful Sara, beautiful S-A-R-A-L-E-E, Sara. Ballard asked Kander and Ebb to write a more special piece for her, in which Kander dug into his bag of tricks of a more classical legato style, which would be different from what they had been successful with thus far with songs like Sara Lee. Ballard was a comedian on the Perry Como show and had to pass the song to the more serious Sandy Stewart, who presented the song to the show's viewers. Pictured in the picture, from left to right, Fred Ebb, Sandy Stewart, Tommy Volando, and John Kander back in 1962, holding their Grammy nominations, the song became a hit, and watching was the great Barbra Streisand, who eventually added the song to her renowned, the second Barbra Streisand album. Offering a more serious lyric, constant metaphors with direct reference to sadness, such as the heart being blue or the beads being green with envy, crescendoing with the melody a stunning climactic chorus of emotion, simple yet impactful, was My Coloring Book. In case you fancy coloring books, and certain people do, here's a new one for you. A most unusual coloring book, the kind you'd never see. Crayons ready, very well, begin to color me. All the eyes that watched him as he walked away. Color them gray. This is the heart that thought he would always.
always be true. Cover it blue. These are the arms that held him and touched him and lost him somehow. Color them empty now. These are the beads that wore until she came between. Color them green. This is the room I sleep in and walk in and weep in and hide in so nobody sees. Color it lonely, please. This is the man that I once depended upon. Cover him gone.
The Kander and Ebb collaboration is a contradiction of styles that drew the attention of many stars and producers. Kander demonstrated a sentimental and lyrical artistic style, while Ebb demonstrated a more campy and cynical style. Taken from the book Kander and Ebb by James Levy, Kander described the moment-to-moment process of a typical Kander and Ebb writing session. We used to sit around the kitchen table first and have some coffee or tea or something and talk. We'd gossip, then lead into whatever it was we were going to have a conversation in, which we would be about people, trying to find what they're talking about. And we'd gradually get into the little room, and we'd go on the piano. I'd find a rhythmic feeling, or sometimes just a whole melodic idea, whatever my fingers happened to be doing that day on the piano. And maybe it won't feel right, and we'll both know it. And then we'll take another track. Or first, I have this quatrain. I'll mess around with it for a little bit. I'll say, well, what if we give this a different rhythmic life? If we alter the pattern just a little bit. He, Ebb, is always accommodating. And here we start to think and to write. And then if you have a musical setting, even if it's not the piece that I'm going to end up with, if I have a kind of structure, then I'll go sit in the other chair and we'll play with it lyrically. And Fred will go to the typewriter. When I say we write together, we literally do. Right before their iconic meet and greet, Kander made his composing debut in 1962 with the musical A Family Affair, which many considered a not-so-successful flop. Around the same time, Fred Ebb had just also not have a successful flop with his debut stage production of the musical Morning Sun. But after writing Coloring Book, they collaborated on their first stage musical, Golden Gate. This collaboration for Golden Gate led to producer Harold Prince, which hired the duo for their first Broadway debut as a duo, the musical Flora the Red Menace. This was the musical that offered the great Liza Minnelli her Broadway debut and provided foresight towards the direction in which the duo was headed, as the musical featured a strong heroine and a dose of politics mixed in as well. Mixed in. Although the musicals Flora and A Family Affair were considered flops, John Kander mentioned that the great Harold Prince really enjoyed his time with the duo as their producer, and that no matter how well Flora the Red Menace did in the public eye, they would meet again and continue their collaboration. Cabaret, with over 1,165 Broadway performances, several Tony Awards, including Best Musical and Best Score, Cabaret was Kander and Ebb's big break. Cabaret was headed to the big screen, where Liza Minnelli once again associated herself with the Kander and Ebb duo. making its meteor-like debut onto the Broadway stage. Cabaret, the musical, made its debut in 1966. Playbill.com gives us a clear snapshot of the synopsis. The show, set in 1931 Berlin as the Nazis were poised to come to power, unfolds at a sleazy establishment called the Kit Kat Club. The performers offer commentary on the harshness of the world closing in around them by representing it audaciously through sex, vulgar humor, and city pizzazz. That is, in startling contrast of Cabaret's serious stories of anti-Semitism, homosexuality, and abortion.
Money makes the world go around, the world go around, the world go around. Money makes the world go around, it makes the world go round. A mark, a yen, a buck, or a pound, a buck. Or a pound, a buck, or a pound is all that makes the world go round, that clinking, clanking sound can make the world go money, 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 money. If you happen to be rich and in need for a night's entertainment, you can pay for a gay escapade. If you happen to be rich and alone and you need a companion, you can ring ting-a-ling for the maid. If you happen to be rich, find you are left by your lover, though you moan and you groan quite a lot, you can take it on the chin, call a cab, and begin to recover. Your 14 carat yacht. Yes, that's right. Money makes the world go around, the world go around, the world go around. Money makes the world go around, a clinking, clanking sound of round. Money, 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 money. Money, 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 money. If you haven't any coal in the stove, and you freeze in the winter, and you cuss at the wind of your fate. If you haven't any shoes of your feet, and your coat's in this paper, then you look to the pounds on the weight. When you gotta get a word of advice from the fat little pastor, he will tell you to love Eleanor. But when hunger comes to rock, ta 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 ta, out the window. Window, hunger, yes, baby, see how love flies out the door. For money makes the world go around, the world go around, the world go around. Money makes the world go around, clinking, clanking sound of money, 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 money. Get a little money, money, money. Mark a yen, a buck or a pound, that clinking, clanking, clanking sound is all that makes the world go round. It makes the world go round.
The juxtaposition of serious narratives against overt optimism, celebratory escapism, and blatant delusion would become a recurring theme throughout many of their works, including Chicago in 1975, Kiss of the Spider-Woman in 1993, Steel Pier in 1997, The Scottboro Boys in 2010, and The Visit in 2015. And here you have it, a list of their Broadway musicals provided by James Leeb's Kander and Ebb book. On a side note, part of the reason I fell in love with the concept of theater was because of its impact on an audience of people. I have heard and have been told many times that actors in theater hold an unfiltered mirror up for society to watch and see unfold in a world written by the people from these societies. One thing that made Kander and Ebb's musical theater so special was the impact the music has on the people that watch their plays and hear their music. They were positioned to take musical theater towards a more realistic point of view. They were amongst a group of artists that opened up conversation and the genre to important topics and extremes in society. The conversation on sexuality, the conversation on religion, the conversation on real life assassinations, including political ones, such as the assassination of Kennedy, and more. Don't get me wrong, Kander and Ebb honored musical theater as a form of entertainment for the masses. But they also used the genre to tell important stories with references to the world they were written in. John Kander and Fred Ebb are often known more for their iconic hits than their names, as seen in this video.
Kander and Ebb?
What's Kander and Ebb? Fred Kander and somebody Ebb.
Who?
Or maybe the other way around.
Who's Kander and Ebb? Can you tell me?
Kander and Ebb have been collaborating longer than any other team.
I don't know how many years they've been together now.
It takes more than talent to have longevity.
Almost 40? Yes, I guess that's a long time.
Come on, babe, why don't we paint the town? And all that jazz, I'm gonna lose my knees and roll my stockings down. And all that jazz, start a car, I know a beat spot.
Mr. Cellophane, famously sung by John C. Reilly from Chicago the Movie. Cabaret, famously sung by Liza Minnelli from Cabaret the Movie. All That Jazz, sung by Catherine Zeta-Jones from the film version of Chicago. And of course, New York, New York, which was famously sung by Liza Minnelli and made even more popular by Frank Sinatra. All songs by John Kander and Fred Ebb. Just hearing the words, All That Jazz and New York, New York starts music in my own head. I'm sure it does yours too. All That Jazz. Oh! Not only did John Kander and Fred Ebb land success with writing music for the music they wrote for Broadway, but after amassing a beautiful 7 Tony Awards with Cabaret the Musical, they wrote Money Money for the 1972 film version of Cabaret, which led to this and other Broadway shows, including Chicago in 1975. And that same year, they wrote songs for the classic Funny Girl film starring Barbra Streisand. And then they wrote music for Liza Minnelli films A Matter of Time in 1976 and New York, New York in 1977. Kander tells a story about the process of writing the score for New York, New York. All songs by John Kander and Fred Ebb. It was actor Robert De Niro who actually played a great influence in the process of writing the music. You have the director Martin Scorsese, John, Fred, all in the same room, and De Niro in the living room. An alternative version of New York, New York, the song was being written for the film, and De Niro overheard the song. De Niro conversed with Scorsese, and Scorsese told John and Fred that the song The World Goes Round sounded like a better choice for the film's climactic moment. John said he and Fred went back to their apartment and said, Really? Some actor's gonna tell us what's good for the film? So Kander played a chord, the famous beginning vamp we know today from the song New York, New York. And Ebb looked over and began writing. He was right, said the duo. Suddenly, it was a collaboration with an actor that led to the writing of one of the most recognizable songs in the history of show tunes. The final song from New York, New York became an absolute smash when Frank Sinatra picked it up and sang it in 1978 at one of his Radio City Music Hall performances. It was such a smash of a performance that Sinatra recorded it for his 1980 album, Trilogy. It has since become one of his signature hits, and it is without a doubt a pop cultural moment. The song is synonymous with New York, and it has inspired many to embrace the idea that New York is a place to live out their dreams. I will now sing for you New York, New York by John Kander and Fred Ebb.
Start spreading the news, I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it, New York, New York. These vagabond shoes are longing to stray and step around the heart of it, New York, New York. I want to wake up in that city that doesn't sleep, to find I'm king of the hill, top of the heap. My little town blues are melting away. I'll make a brand new start of it, New York, New York. If I can make it there, I'll make it anywhere. Come on, come through, New York. That doesn't sleep, to find I'm king of the hill, head of the crop, a number one at the top of the heap. My little town blues are melting away. To be a part of it, New York, New York. If I can make it there, I'll make it anywhere. Come on, come through, New York, New York.
Composer John Kander and lyricist Fred Ebb collaborated for more than 40 years. Longer than any such partnership in Broadway history. Bet ya didn't know that. Together, they wrote over 20 musicals. Their two most successful works, Cabaret and Chicago, had critically acclaimed Broadway revivals and were made into Oscar-winning films. Since 1996, not one day has passed without at least one Kander and Ebb musical occupying Broadway theater. Chicago is the longest-running revival in Broadway history and is still going strong. As an aspiring artist myself, I am incredibly grateful to them, and I am honored to have the opportunity to sing their music and share with you just a snippet of their amazing story. My final selection is my go-to audition song from Kander and Ebb's Women of the Year from 1981, I present to you the song we started with, Sometimes a Day Goes By.
Sometimes a day goes by, one whole entire day, when I don't think of her. 24 hours pass, I look around and find that I haven't thought of her, not even if that somewhere we used to go, not even if that someone we used to know. It's hardly every day, it's most unusual, in fact. I can't remember when, but sometimes a day goes by that I don't think of her.